الحمد لله، الحمد لله وحده، والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وما أمروا إلا ليعبدوا الله مخلصين له الدين. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى. صدق الله العظيم. Respected elders, brothers, mothers and sisters, I've recited an ayat of Surah Bayyinah in front of you, and also a very famous hadith. And inshallah, if Allah Ta'ala gives us the tawfiq of saying a few words on both the ayat and the hadith of Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The hadith, as you are aware, is a very famous hadith. In fact, many muhaddith, many people of hadith have included this hadith in the beginning of the compilations. So Imam Bukhari rahmatullah alayhi, Imam Mishkat, Imam Baghawi have all narrated this hadith in the very beginning of the compilation. Some ulama have even gone to the extent of saying that this hadith is one third of deen, because it deals with our heart and deals with one of the most important aspects of our life. Amongst the benefits and amongst the lessons we learn from this hadith, إِنَّمَا الْعَمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ, when Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had said that our deeds would be judged by the motives and niyat and intentions made for those deeds. Now, among the lessons we learn is, firstly, we as Muslims many a times, although we have been commanded, we have lost in many ways the art of making intention for our deeds. It just seemed to be something that we don't consider. My Ustad Hazrat Mawlana Idris Mirti Rahmatullah Ali, he taught us many kitabs, he taught us Jalalain, taught us Sahih Muslim. And he wrote a Urdu commentary on Riyadhus Salihin. And in there, one of the aspects that he made, he said that Nek niyati ek mustaqil ibadatah. He said, good intention is an independent good deed in its own right. Said, good intention is an independent good deed in its own right. And sometimes you and I, we don't seem to consider this as an important aspect. We don't make niyat for our deeds. And where he also brought this, there is a hadith of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And when Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was going to the battle of Tabuk, on the way Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told the sahaba and said, there are people who are not with us in this journey, but ما سلكنا شعبة ولا واديا إلا وهم معنا حبسهم العذر. From here you can see the importance of niyat and intention. He said, whatever valley we cross in this expedition, they are with us in reward, but they could not join us because they had a valid reason for not joining us. But because the intention was to join us, every act of good we do in this journey, they will share the reward. Solely on the basis of intention. In fact, the ulama have made mention that many good deeds, Allah has promised many rewards for it. But that rewards are dependent for making a niyat for it. To make wudu, for example, is a very great act of ibadat. Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had said, one day sahaba asked Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, on the day of judgment, how would you be able to recognize us? How would you be able to recognize us? You will be in a pedestal. Allah will grant you respect and honor. How would you be able to see us ordinary ummatis? So Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, let me give an example. If there is a valley full of black horse, and within that there is one horse that is white in color, would I be able to pick up the white horse within the black horses? He said, yes, Ya Rasulullah, obviously you will be able to pick it up. He said, in a similar manner on the day of judgment, I would be able to pick you up because of the noor that will radiate from those parts of the body that you used to wash in wudu. I would be able to pick you up from that. The noor that will come out from there, I will be able to know this is a believer. But our ulama say that reward is dependent upon us making niyat before we make wudu. Otherwise, without niyat, if you just make wudu and wash the limbs of your body which are compulsory to wash, it will be permissible for you to perform salat with that. But all these rewards are dependent upon niyat, are dependent on you doing it for the sake of Allah. So one important aspect that we learn is to make niyat for our deeds. And in niyat, there are a few things. One is a niyat for a good deed that will be for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like at the time of wudu you do. The second is for mundane acts that you and I do on a regular basis as a matter of routine. Now, there also we don't make niyat. Brother Khalid Beg wrote this, you know, very remarkable book, First Things First. In there he has made mention of two types of ibadat. One he calls direct ibadat and indirect ibadat. Not something that comes directly from the Quran and Hadith, but you can glean it from indications from the Quran and Hadith. One is a direct ibadat in the sense that from its very own, you can see that this is an ibadat in its own right. Allah has commanded it. Aqimu salat, perform salat. So while Allah has performed salat for the sake of aqimu salata li dhikri, establish salat for my remembrance. Now clear cut injunction of the Quran and Allah Ta'ala to perform salat for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's an ibadat in its own right. And it has many benefits. Ibadat, direct ibadat. Now you know one of the benefits of ibadat, direct ibadat, is it grants our hearts contentment. Allah Ta'ala says, Allah بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَتْمَعِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. Verily in the zikr of Allah, by remembering Allah through the means of salat, zikr, tilawat, does hearts find contentment. One of the reasons why today there is no contentment is because people have forgotten relationship with Allah. People have forgotten zikr of Allah. Today we regard it as an insignificant thing. You know, this brother Junaid Jamshed, I'm sure many people have heard about him, the person who was a former singer and then he changed his life and now he sings a nasheed. I don't want to talk about that aspect of his life, but there is one aspect when he speaks about his life. A very good friend, alhamdulillah, from time to time we discuss many things when he has been here and other. So when he starts to discuss his life, he says, I had in my life everything that a young person in Pakistan would crave for. I had name, I had fame, I had wealth. My picture was on the billboards throughout Pakistan because I used to advertise, people used to use my name for advertising. I used to get wealth, one contract of mine for marketing used to run, never mind in rupees, hundreds of thousands of dollars. And I had everything, but I was never satisfied. I had a vacuum in my life. So you say, one day I made mention of that to an alim, to a scholar. I said, why is it like that? I got everything. I should be happy. So he said, this alim told me, Junaid bhai, your problem is, you got a wound on your right knee, you're applying the ointment on the left knee. How is Allah going to make you better? You got a wound on the right knee, instead of putting the ointment on the right knee, you're putting ointment on the left knee. How is Allah going to make you better? So he said, explain it to me. What's the situation? He said, Allah has kept contentment in zikr. You are looking for contentment in name and fame. Where is Allah going to give it to you? Make your relationship with Allah, Allah will give you contentment. So this is direct ibadat. Now there's other aspects which we call indirect ibadat. What indirect ibadat means, that those could be routine matters of life, which could be turned into ibadat with correct intention and correct methodology. Now to understand this, let us understand it through the means of a hadith. Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Dawud Sharif's hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sitting with a gathering of Sahaba and one young person passed by there running very fast. He ran a couple of times past the gathering. One Sahabi said, Ya Rasulullah, if only this person could have displayed the same enthusiasm for the sake of Allah, in the path of Allah. Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what do you know, what is his situation? Maybe he's running with the intention of being independent. He must not be relying upon someone. Then he's in a path of Allah. Maybe he's running and showing enthusiasm to look after his aging parents. He's in a path of Allah. Maybe he's running with the intention of feeding his small children who are dependent upon him. For huwa fi sabilillah. He's in a path of Allah. But if he's running to gain wealth, to keep up with the Joneses, فَهُوَ فِي سَبِيلِ الشَّيْطَانِ رِيَا وَمُفَخَرَةً. The hadith says, if he's running with the intention of riya and name and fame, for who fi sabili shaitan, is in a path of shaitan. Now what you and I would say, I'm going out for a job in the early hours of the morning. I'm doing it as a matter of routine. And one is, I'm doing it because the Nabi of Allah and Allah has told us to earn halal risk is a religious obligation. Now you can see what a vast difference in the two. In the time of Eid, after Fajr, we give the sunnah. So I tell the people, nearly every one of us will take a shower. Every one of us will, you know, make miswak or brush our teeth. Every one of us will do and wear our best clothes. But do we ever say we are doing it because the Nabi of Allah told us to do it? Or we're doing it because a routine matter of Eid, everyone does it, I'm also doing it. Now just look at the difference. So indirect ibadat means those mundane activities which can become deen by proper intention. And really in this way we can turn mere dust into gold. Mere dust we're turning into gold just by a little bit of intention. And then this third thing is, these evil deeds would not be made correct by correct intention. There's one thing we're going to say. Not every sincere deed is correct. Sometimes there can be sincerity but doesn't make it correct. A person one day saw a bird with a long beak, felt the bird pity. How can this bird ever be able to eat? How is it going to eat? Look at how long is its beak. Where is it going to get the food? Broke the beak. After a few days, that bird died. He did it out of sincerity, but the bird died. Because not every sincere act is good. So, and especially with evil deeds, it doesn't make it right by proper intention. You know, there was this one incident of a woman who was in India, Pakistan. India, Pakistan got certain peculiarities which we people, you know, we who have studied India, Pakistan know. So there they have one woman, her husband's name was Rahmatullah. So she had two sons, Muhammad and Ahmad. So someone one day told her that you must not call your husband by his name, first name. It's not a direct command of Allah. It's not a matter of haram or halal. But there are indications that Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was not called by his first name by Allah out of respect. Out of respect. So therefore, some ulama have made mention, as I said, not a matter of halal and haram, that because Allah has told the wife to respect the husband, if you don't call by the first name, call by some titles. The way Allah has called the Nabi of Allah by Nabi and Rasul, call him by something. So she heard, I must not call my husband by the first name. So the husband's name was Rahmatullah. So how much she read namaz, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. So she said, now how am I going to do this? The Maulana said, I must not read. So when she came to, they said, Assalamu alaikum Muhammad ka Abba, Assalamu alaikum Muhammad ka Abba. The intention might have been correct, but doesn't make the correct deed correct. So the first thing is that when we learn from this hadith is that intention. This is something that you and I, we sometimes slip up with. The second thing is, since we have to make intention, now we're doing good deeds, what intention do we make? Firstly, I think we must make intention for reward. We must not hide our intention. Each and everyone, you and I, we like to get things for free, especially Indian people. We will go 50 kilometers and spend 50 rand petrol to get something discounted for 10 rand. That is one of the peculiarities of our. We all like our freebies. So Allah Ta'ala says, don't hide away what you know what you have in your heart. Ask for reward of your deeds. But don't ask it from human being. Human being is very ungrateful. Human being is very, very ungrateful. He will never be able to reward you sufficiently for what you have done to him. Therefore, whenever you do good to a human being, don't do it to gain his reward or to gain his thanks. You would become very, very disappointed. Do it and seek reward, but seek it from Allah. Ya qawmi la as'alukum alayhi ajra in ajriya illa ala Allah. Look at the 19th surah of the Holy Quran. Every Nabi of Allah started off his message by telling his people, oh my qawm, I don't ask no reward from you. I'm doing it for the sake of Allah. My reward is with Allah. Seek reward, but seek it from Allah. So our intention must be to seek reward, but seek it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now this sometimes can be very, very difficult because we always have certain hidden desires to seek name, fame. Now do it only for the sake of Allah. This ayat which I've recited, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ. We have been commanded that worship Allah alone مخلصين only for Allah. Imam Ibn Arabi rahmatullah alayhi writes that when this ayat was revealed, the heavens and earth stood still for a moment because of the implications of this ayat. So the heavens and earth stood still for a moment. وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُوا اللَّهِ. Make your ibadat solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And no other aspects. Only do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't seek any other reward. Don't seek any other aspects. And this is something that ulama and the people of the past used to look at their motives, and they used to repeatedly look at their motives ruthlessly to see that it's only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, this is Sheikh Ahmad Shaheed rahmatullah alayhi, Sheikh Ismail Shaheed rahmatullah alayhi, was a remarkable human being in terms of people who fought against colonialism in the last century or so. I think this must have been one of the most remarkable resistance against colonialism. When you look at it, read his life, Sheikh Ismail Shaheed rahmatullah alayhi, the type of effort, the type of piety, the type of preparations for jihad that he made, in terms of preparing himself physically, used to swim from Delhi to Agra. All of those things are made mention in his life. But, you know, the sincerity Allah had granted him. One day he, because of when he started off his mission, people used to come far and wide to listen to him. The Jami Masjid of Delhi used to be full. And anyone who had seen that knows. One day he gave a talk to the entire Jami Masjid was full to capacity, and he gave a talk. After the talk, as he was going out, one person came running up the steps of the Jami Masjid. He said, Sheikh, I came from so far and I came to listen to your talk, but I missed the talk. I came, and he made mention how far he came from. Sheikh Ismail Shaheed rahmatullah alayhi took him back to the masjid. The way he spoke to thousands of people, he gave the same talk to that one person. When he finished, his disciples and his people, his students said, Hazrat, we can understand there were thousands of people you gave, but for one person, you spend the entire talk, you gave the same talk again to one person? What a remarkable reply. He said, the first time I also spoke for one. The first time I also spoke for one. I only spoke for Allah Ta'ala. I wasn't speaking to the thousands of people. So whether I spoke to one person, I spoke to thousands, the same thing was there. So Allah must always give us that sincerity of purpose, that we only do things for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abdul Rahman Mazrawi rahmatullah alayhi makes mention that we were in the fighting against the Romans in the early stages of Islam, and there was one person who showed remarkable bravery, and he had hid himself and he covered himself, his face, with a cloth. And afterwards I went behind him and I said, who is this person who was showing such remarkable bravery? He went into his tent and he took out his scarf, and I saw it was a famous scholar, Abdullah ibn Mubarak rahmatullah alayhi, the ustad of Imam Bukhari rahmatullah alayhi. So Imam, when he saw me, he said, are you going to defame me by publicizing my act? Are you going to defame me by publicizing the fact that I was brave in the battlefield? So doing things solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, if we don't do it for Allah, we'll manage to convince people. Some or the other, you manage to convince people, but you won't get the reward by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah won't reward you. Maulana Umar Palanpuri, which Sheikh Yawar made mention of, his, you know, remarkable human being, used to give some remarkable examples. So he gave this example. He said, just imagine you have to do a building, and you call the builder to build a building. This is a person by the name of Abdul Qadir. Abdul Qadir had to construction. So he called the builder to build a building for him. After putting up the building, the builder went to Abdul Sattar. Abdul Sattar bhai, give me money for the building I have constructed. Abdul Sattar bhai will say, bhai, who did you do the building for? So, did it for Abdul Qadir? So, you did it for Abdul Qadir, why are you asking me for money? Go and ask Abdul Qadir for money. I mean, isn't it pure logic? Abdul Sattar will say, you didn't do it for me, why are you asking me for money? Go and ask Abdul Qadir for money, you did it for Abdul Qadir. Similarly, if Allah on the day of Qiyamah were to tell us, bhai, who did you do this good deeds for? Did you do it for name and fame? You did it for other people, why are you asking me for reward? Go and ask them for reward. Why are you asking me for reward? Sheikh Sadi rahmatullah alayhi, as I made mention, used to give some of these beautiful examples. So he said one day, a person, apparent pious person, was went to the king. Right now, because he wanted to show his piety in front of the king, you know, he made a very long namaz, longer than what he normally does when he's at home. So he took his small child with him. Children are very innocent. Children are innocent. You can't believe the innocence. They will say things in innocence which sometimes will blow your mind away. So he made mention one day that the inspector was going around, asked the small child, why you call the tongue that you speak at home mother tongue? You say Gujarati is mother tongue, Urdu is mother tongue. You don't say it's father tongue. Why is it? He said, home mommy speaks so much, father never gets a chance to say it. Mother tongue. So anyway, he took the small child with. He made this long salat. Then at the time of eating, he ate very little. The king said, eat, look at all the delicacies. No, I normally eat very little to show his piety. But now when he came home, he was hungry. That's why I tell our young people, they eat fast foods, they eat burger when they come home, mommy give us more to eat. No barakat in those fast foods. But there it is, always there. He came home and he asked the wife, give me something to eat. So the son is looking, they say, why are you eating again? He said, some hikmat, some wisdom. You know, so he said, you're eating again because, he maybe picked up, he was 8-9 years, he said, you're eating again because there you wanted to show the king something. So you're eating again. So he said, you didn't eat there, despite the fact there was food, so now you're eating again as a qaza for that food you didn't eat. Right? Now, that salat that you did to impress the king, why don't you read that also again? That salat that you did to impress the king, not for the sake of Allah, why don't you read that also again? So the second thing is, we must always be, do our deeds solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيُتِيمُونَ التَّعَامَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينَ وَيَتِيمَ وَعَسِيرًا. You know, Allah Ta'ala makes mention that even when you feed people, do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And my reward for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not for anyone else. And then the third thing is, we have to always worry with regard to our contamination of our intentions and motive. اللهم طهر قلبي من النفاق وعملي من الرياء. Oh Allah, you keep our hearts clean from nifaq and our amal from riya. Riya is such a thing that Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam has made mention. The first three people who will go into Jahannam will be the alim, the generous person, and the mujahid, because they did it for the sake of human beings instead of doing it for the sake of Allah. Allah, they will ask Allah, tell him, what did you do? He said, I was very generous. I had so much knowledge, I passed on this knowledge. I did this, I did that. Allah will say, you did it so that you could gain name and fame, you got it. Now you got no reward from me. Go into the fire of Jahannam. Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Nahnu natadhakkaru al-Masih ad-Dajjal." Sahaba say, we were talking about Masih ad-Dajjal one day. And Nabi Karim sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Should I not tell you something that is even a greater fitna than Masih ad-Dajjal for yourself?" Said, "Ya Rasulullah, do tell us." And normally I also tell people from this hadith, we learn one important aspect. People sometimes talk about various types of fitnas, etc. And there are fitnas are there. Sometimes Qadianism and Shiism and all of those type of things are there. But while those things are there, and we always got to be aware of it, we sometimes lose focus of the fitna that is directly in front of us. Perhaps today, one of the greatest fitna is indifference to deen. People are not interested in deen. Never mind talking about Qadianism, they might be, and I'm not undermining it. If a person who is a Qadiani can never be in the fold of Islam. He's out of the fold of Islam. But in terms of percentage, how many people are there who are doing that, and how many people are just not worried about deen, indifference to deen? Deen doesn't matter in their life. Nevertheless, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam talked about Masih Dajjal and said, yes, Masih Dajjal is a fitna, but can I tell you something that is much more common? And Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, tell us. He said, shirk-e khafi. And he said, concealed shirk. Ya Rasulullah, what is concealed shirk? And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, concealed shirk is, you do things to please someone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is concealed shirk. So this is an aspect of an important, and sometimes you see, we do things and there are other benefits that come, and therefore it is always so important for us to ruthlessly examine our motives. Sometimes it can come in the same of name, fame, recognition, honor. You know, So all the time we have to see ourselves with regard to, you know, حاسبوا أنفسكم قبل أن تحاسبوا. Take stock of your deeds, evaluate your deeds before Allah Ta'ala evaluate your deeds. When Allah Ta'ala evaluate your deeds, it will be perhaps too late. But now we have to evaluate our deeds, and we have to, part of that evaluation is to evaluate our motives. So let us keep this beautiful hadith in mind, where Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, إِنَّمَا الْعَمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ وَإِنَّمَا لِكُلِّ مْرِئٍ مَّا نَوَاهُ. That our deeds will be judged by the intentions we make for it, and each and every person will be rewarded according to his intention. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq of understanding and making amal. وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ.